Tag auch, hier ist Marius aus Hamburg.
This video is inspired by 123toys video The Reveal DIY Micro Speakers Free Build Plans with Sound Test, but also fits for many other videos I've seen and commented recently. Disclaimer, in this video I use BoxSim to demonstrate how the effect of each crossover part work. I'm afraid it's the German version and not even the newest one. BoxSim is a very powerful freeware tool which takes the effect of the front baffle around the drivers into account. It comes with data for nearly all VisaTone drivers and crossover parts. You can also import your own data. This is not a tutorial particularly for that software. Leo Loudspeaker already did a very good one, though only in German. You'll find his channel among related on my channel. You can, of course, use any other software you like, but BoxSim has some very useful features. You can also, for example, use measurement software like ATA and real hardware for crossover parts and speakers, which is even the more accurate way. I will also not describe how to pick the right enclosure size for your woofer. I'll assume that you've already done that, which of course has to be done before designing the crossover. Maybe I'll make another video about that topic. If I already did, since making this video, the info icon will now pop up, where you'll find the link. Leave a request below if you can't find anything adequate here on YouTube. I'll start with a small compact speaker with a 4-inch full-range driver as a midwoofer and a 1-inch soft dome tweeter randomly selected from the included database. I put them in a 1.6 liter, 98 cubic inches closed box. I'll assume you already know what a first, second or third order crossover does, and that there's also something like a buffer step correction circuit existing. There are many online calculators for both available. BoxSim also has a built-in one, so you might get the idea to just use both a first order filter and a buffer step correction circuit in series to get your desired result. Here you can see that this doesn't work and those calculators are not very useful. The slope in the highs is not steep enough, blue curve. Only from minus 20 dB on, it won't add to the summed up response. This can be substituted by a single coil with the values summed up, which nearly gives the same crappy result. What is a good result anyway? Hi-fi comes from high fidelity and means that the original sound should be changed as little as possible through recording and reproduction. The German DIY loudspeaker magazine Hobby Hi-Fi say that for a speaker this means that the frequency response has to be as balanced and linear as possible. Distortion and resonances have to be as low as possible. Mechanical loss is also an important issue, they say, because it is highly non-linear in mechanical elements as suspension and soft materials as plastic cones or dampening varnishes. That causes different behavior of materials at high and low volumes. At low volumes, and thus small membrane excursions, the movement is dampened more than at large excursions. This is also my goal in speaker design. Thus we take another approach. Usually it's helpful to start with a midwoofer because the bass defines the maximum level. Without a crossover, its response has a huge hump in the mids. That's the baffle step, which I won't explain here. Maybe I'll make another video about the topic. Again, click the info icon or leave a request below. As you can see, this is not really a step, so a high shelf filter as baffle step correction circuit doesn't work. We'll search for the point where the hump is 3 dB louder than the bass, that's here about 800 Hz. The frequency and impedance at that point I put into the calculator. I choose the next available value and put it in the crossover. That was too much, so I use a smaller value. This flattens the baffle step. The easiest way now is to steepen the slope in the highs and choose the crossover point with a capacitor in parallel. Of course, you should check beforehand if that point is feasible for your drivers. It should be at least one octave distance from the resonant frequency of the tweeter, especially if it has ferrofluid. It will work for the midwoofer if there are no resonances or distortion peaks in the desired frequency range. You can see that from small peaks or notches in the frequency response, which correspond with peaks in the impedance response, ridges in the waterfall spectrum, and/or peaks in the distortion plot. You can measure those plots while the drivers are mounted in your enclosure. Maybe I'll make another video about that topic. Again, click the info icon or leave a request below. If the driver has some serious resonances near the crossover frequency, it might need either a serious RCL filter in parallel to the driver or a third order filter. That depends on what works better. On with the tweeter. Let's start with the voltage divider. I use the built-in calculator. A voltage divider has the advantage of a slight linearization of the impedance of the tweeter over a single resistor, as you can see here. The theoretical values of a second order filter for the crossover frequency don't work due to the hump in the frequency response at the resonance frequency. I changed the values until it looks good, but the slopes of both drivers aren't symmetrical and thus not ideal. Also, the impedance drops at 5 kHz below 4 ohms, so I double the resulting impedance with the voltage divider, double the inductance and half the capacitance. To improve the slope, I switch to a third order filter and vary the values a bit. The slopes are now symmetrical and the sum at the crossing point is exactly 6 decibels above it. Now I'll try to round the edges of the low pass by adding a resistor. That resulted in playing around with several values, one at a time, to see if the step goes into the right direction. BoxSim has a built-in tool that can also do that for you, but you can't define the crossover frequency, which might run out of the suitable range. This is the result, and here is the comparison to what we started with. The next step would be to change all values again during an optimization of an angle of 30 degrees, red curve. I changed a few values of the high pass filter. Now it looks straight at 30 degrees to the side. And you know, if it looks straight, it is straight. Usually, a speaker sounds better that way, especially if you don't turn them towards you. You can also see that if you compare the lower curves, it has now a better balance. Those curves are the frequency response of the whole acoustical energy emitted to all angles. Of course, the on-axis curve is now below the 30 degree curve, which can be corrected by rounding or chamfering the edges of the enclosure as far as possible, at least 10% of the baffle width on each side. BoxSim can calculate chamfered edges. Even on-axis, this looks much better. In the end, you have to listen to the speaker with those different crossovers and even vary some values to find out what sounds best. It might be helpful to have a reference speaker to compare with. If you're interested in similar videos for full range, FAST, three-way boxes or others, please write a comment, subscribe and click the like button. Thank you for watching.